the Word became flesh, dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory is as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Tonight we gather beneath the star that marks the way to the Christ child laid in a manger long ago. We make our way with shepherds and angels to the place where he lay. In this manger, the child rests quietly, swaddled, and safe. Tonight we have come to behold the one whose birth to the Virgin Mary was announced by the Archangel Gabriel. We have come to worship the Magi and the shepherds, the child encircled by sheep and oxen, who encircles us, and we are yet unaware. We behold him laid in weakness upon his mother's breast, Joseph standing guard, a child who cannot walk or speak a word, who is also at once the very Word of God. We have come to behold a mystery. A mystery as great as creation itself, for the God who made existence to be makes for himself a human life to dwell in. The Christmas story itself is familiar and comprehensible. Childhood is comprehensible. Some of us can even remember moments when we were 3 or 5 or 9. I don't remember that many when I was 3. Some of us can even remember lots of other things. We know our children and our grandchildren and have watched them grow, and we can understand the Christ child and understand how a child can hold promise, and how Mary's son lying in a manger is a child of promise. And whatever that promise means, we know somehow it means salvation for us. But it is not the virginal birth itself that we come to admire, as great as that miracle is. And the redemption from sin and the mess we're in is not why the angels sing glory to God in the highest. On this eve, we gather to contemplate something greater than this. More than an exemplary life to light the way of wayward mankind, or than an esteemed teacher or spiritual sage, more than salvation from sin, or misery, or shame. The birth of God's Son calls us to consider more deeply incarnation itself, that God came to share our human experience in its entirety and to unite in himself our humanity with his divinity. Whatever we see on this side of the veil of eternity, the angels beheld from the time they came to be. For Christ is begat before all time and they, awakening to life immortal at their first creation before the worlds were made, beheld the Lord among the Trinity, infused with light and life, who now lies in the manger, veiled in the flesh of a human child, surrounded by common hay. At the beginning, in the deep silence before time began, before the universe burst forth in the Big Bang boom, the Christ child that laid in the manger and grew to adulthood beheld the birth of the cosmos with the Most High and the Holy Spirit, the three existing in a unity of self-giving love that causes all things to be. From this eternal fabric, Gabriel visits disclose mystery. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. In this Annunciation, the entire Trinity can be seen. First, the activity of the Holy Spirit passing into and through every atom, every genomic strand in every cell, to her very organs, infusing her with the divine presence, where the Most High, the Lord of hosts, casts his potent and material shadow upon the woman to make in her for himself his own abiding of his magisterial plenitude, his own overflowing majesty that comes to dwell. God Almighty is now manifest in the human being. And as if heaven could not contain itself at that moment, the angelic host burst forth from their place and pierced the dark night where the shepherds stood in spellbound wonder to declare the Son of God is born there in Jerusalem. Their glory to God in the highest is a worship compelled by the incarnation. It demands their worship and ours, not only because he would suffer for our sins, but because he is the Almighty Lord of hosts, the one seated above all the heavenly hosts in their graduated arrays of splendor, because the angels comprehend that the Most High made himself for a little while lower than the angels to take on the entire human realm. And we worship the angels. That beyond us, we can only fall down to our knees and worship and cry out. The entire cosmos is populated by celestial powers too great for us to fathom. But let us consider with the angels that it is the Almighty's willingness to undo himself, to lower himself for the sake of the lesser and humbler creature, that made the Christ child worthy of this adoration. This is the mystery of kenotic love. His self-emptying love is the greatest power in all the cosmos among worlds visible. And yet, the mystery runs deeper still, touching every one of us, every human person. This is why the incarnation is the non-negotiable foundation of the Christian religion. That in Christ's real flesh and blood personhood, the most holy, uncreated God and man come closest to one another and meet in a single human being. And here it becomes obvious before our very eyes, according to one writer, that God is eternally, irreducibly other than man, and that consequently man may therefore not see his salvation in a direction that implies an abandonment of his own nature, but simply in fellowship with God. For God did not come to undermine nature that he himself, as God and Word, had created. That's a lot of words. What does that mean? God created our human nature, and it was good. God made us after his own divine image. So God, uniting himself to our humanity in the real body and person of Jesus, did not swallow up his humanity in his divinity, but intended that they should coexist in one person. This is the mystery of the incarnation. One person, two natures, unconfused, with the human nature given to the divine nature of its own volition, its own free will. This is the Christ we worship. But this mystery is for us. It now becomes our pattern for redemption. Christ holding together within his one person, his own divinity and human nature, now presents us back to ourselves, returning our nature back to ourselves, whole and intact, with God himself. Christ, then, is the pinnacle of us, the incarnation, should have its perfect expression. That God within us, God through the Holy Spirit, in our untrampled humanity, should coexist in one person. That God and your nature should coexist in you as they coexist with Christ. What? The incarnation is the engine of redemption. And even if there were no sin to expiate, to make a sacrifice, this incarnation would have still occurred to unite all things, things in heaven and things on earth, in himself, and to recapitulate, bring them all back together again in God. Now, perhaps we can comprehend the mystery John proclaims when he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And we have neither life nor light without him coexisting in us." May God open our eyes that we may behold the miracle, the mystery that lies in the manger. A babe, yes, born of the Virgin Mary, yes, but also the eternal Word, the Logos, the divine principle and intellect and love that in love made existence to be and made of his own uncreated and unseen substance, brought the Son into being before all time, that he who is life might fill us with the same uncreated light and life. So, there in this very cradle, they venerated him with offerings of gifts, though Jesus was merely a whimpering infant. They perceived one thing with their eyes, with the eyes of their bodies, but another thing with the eyes of their mind. The lowliness of the body, he assumed, was discerned, but the glory of his divinity is now manifest. A boy he is, but it is God who is adored. How inexpressible is the mystery of this divine honor. The invisible and eternal nature did not hesitate to take on the weakness of flesh on our behalf. The Son of God, who is God of the universe, born a human being in the flesh. He permits himself to be placed in a manger, and the heavens are within the manger. He is kept in a cradle, the world cannot afford. Let us worship.
'Twas a humble birthplace, but oh, how much God gave to us that day. From the manger bed, what a path was led, what a perfect holy way.
I don't think we need.